Right. Good morning to everyone who's joining us today. I'm Peter Stevens, and on behalf of TMA, I'm pleased to welcome you to the third seminar we've organised in conjunction with Colliers International. I hope you've managed to have some sort of a summer break and are ready for what I suspect will be a further period of uncertainty and confusion, but hopefully we can help with some guidance today. We're also lining up a series of webinars for the rest of the year, so I'll further details in a moment. For those of you not familiar with TMA, we're a global not-for-profit organisation, and we have the most professionally diverse membership across the corporate restructuring, renewal and turnaround space. With nearly 10,000 members in 53 chapters, TMA allows members to gain access to knowledge and expertise that is vital in dealing with these challenging times businesses now face. The work at TMA is very reliant on our sponsors and members, so I wanted to thank John Pye, our corporate sponsor. We really appreciate their commitment to us in these difficult economic times. As you can see, we also have a range of other supporters who enable us to deliver value to our members, and a big thank you to all of them. I have been amazed by the response we've had to these seminars. We've had nearly 3,500 people log into them so far, and we're extremely grateful to you all for taking the time. We'll continue to work with our partners to bring you what we hope is relevant and useful productions in the very different world we're now working in. To this end, we have three more webinars planned for September and are working on some further events in October and November. So watch out for further details, which can be found on our website. I also mention our European colleagues are hosting an online seminar on the 17th and 18th. Again, details are on our webpage. Of course, there's always room for new supporters and new interest. And if you'd like any details, please do visit our website or contact our business manager, Nairi McGill. That's all I've got to say for the moment. I'll chip in with some comments along the way, but I'll now hand over to Nick Hammond, who's very kindly put this all together for us, and he'll introduce the speakers and take us through the seminar. So Nick, over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter, and good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us for this, which is the third instalment of this webinar series, which we're delighted to be hosting in partnership with the TMA, headed Real Estate Restructuring Strategies Beyond COVID-19. My name, as Peter says, is Nick Hammond, and I head the advisory and restructuring team at Colliers. We provide real estate restructuring, turnaround and insolvency advice to lenders, investors, business management teams and practitioners across all UK property sectors. So what that means is that we get to experience quite a wide range of projects which span businesses of various shapes and sizes. Previously in these webinars, we've discussed the hospitality sector, and we've talked about real estate development. Today, we're going to be focusing on the UK retail sector as it continues in its evolution into what is becoming an ever more connected omni-channel marketplace, which is a bit of a mouthful. And to discuss this, I'm pleased to be joined by a panel of experts. First and foremost, guest speaker for today, happy to be joined by Damien Webb, who's a partner at RSM Restructuring, and himself is a retail restructuring expert. He's worked across a range of transactions over the last couple of years, which have included CVAs and pre-pack administrations. He's recently advised on the accelerated sale of Chilango and is currently advising on a range of other CVAs. We also have David Fox, who is our co-head of UK Retail Agency and works across a national team of 50 in London and 5 regional offices in all aspects of the retail property sector, which I know from our own direct projects includes leasing, asset management and disposal. We also have Lloyd Entwistle, who's a director in our retail agency and development team. Lloyd is focused primarily on repurposing retail assets, which we'll look at in a few minutes' time, within major towns and cities, and really asking what other uses could we find for these properties. And they include things like hotels, student residential, and mixed-use schemes. We have Matt Thompson, who heads our retail strategy team. He specializes in data analytics, consumer insight, and real estate strategy. So Matt utilizes big data, amongst other things, to deliver bespoke consultancy solutions for landlords, investors, and operators across the UK and on the continent. And we also, of course, have Peter Stevens, who you've just heard from, who alongside his role as the chair of the TMA in the UK, is also a senior advisor and chair of credit committee at SME Capital. So he'll be giving us some insight on what lenders are thinking at the moment. If you've watched these webinars previously, you'll know that typically we've had each of our panelists give their own brief presentation, and we've come to some audience questions at the end. We're going to use a slightly different format today, whereby that the entire session will be more of a Q&A, more of a roundtable discussion, and we'll encourage, as ever, audience participation. So for those of you not familiar with Zoom, if you hover your cursor over the screen you're looking at, there's a Q&A button at the bottom. Please use that to submit any questions that you have for any of our speakers in particular, or indeed for the panel as a whole, and we'll come to those questions either at the end or as we go through the session. So let's get into it. We're going to start with looking at the role of the high street. And I suppose to get into this, it's worth pointing out footfall in recent weeks, based on data from Springboard and others, has been steadily increasing. Online retail sales, interestingly, while still a large proportion and a growing proportion of spend, actually declined in July. And I suspect the same was true in August, as spending patterns shifted back towards the high street and the bars and restaurants, which are now reopened. But whilst business confidence has increased for three consecutive months, as indicated by the Lloyds Bank Business Barometer out a few weeks ago, consumer confidence remains low because it's overshadowed by job security and personal finance concerns. So our first sort of string of questions, I think I'm going to bring in probably Matt on this one initially, and ask David and Lloyd to add their thoughts. What is happening among consumers at the moment, and how do you expect shopping and spending habits to evolve over the weeks and the months ahead?
Okay, yeah, I'll take that one, Nick, and morning, everyone. I think looking ahead, I'll start with this, the longer-term picture, and actually sort of do it the other way around. The longer-term picture, and this is something that, as a team, we've been giving a considerable amount of thought around, particularly since lockdown began, and I want to draw on some of our own research, actually, to highlight some of the themes here that I think are going to be pertinent going forward. From our own research, this was prior to COVID-19, so we'd expect this to have exacerbated further. Over 50% of online transactions for a number of stores and brands that we've done analysis for took place actually within 5 miles of a shop. So I think that's a really pertinent stat that, particularly at these times, as it's those operators that do not have an optimized store portfolio and an efficient web-based platform are those that are falling by the wayside. And particularly during these challenging times, it's those retailers that continue to innovate, and the retailer sector is full of them. We have to remember that. So I think looking ahead, we can expect fewer, better stores. The role of the store will be to drive higher levels of engagement, attract new customers, and of course retain existing shoppers. But I think also from an online perspective, stores will have a more important role to play in the fulfillment chain. So, and we've heard a lot recently in the press about how online brands are struggling to deliver a profitable online only platform. So I think stores play a really pivotal role in improving operational costs from that in that perspective. So I think looking ahead, the new map for a store network will be to deliver space in the right locations to deliver a competitive advantage online and offline. So some of those were sort of ringing pre-COVID, but I think, as we've heard a lot recently, COVID has accelerated those trends.
Okay, thanks, Matt. David, do you have anything to add to that in terms of what are consumers doing and how do we think their shopping habits might evolve? David, I think you're on mute.
I am not, though. There we go. Yes, thanks, Nick, and good morning, everybody. I think it probably sounds obvious to say, but obviously the whole COVID-19 lockdown crisis has hit consumer confidence, no doubt, and to the extent that looking at Bank of England figures in April this year, consumer debt actually dropped by the biggest proportion that's ever done since they started ticking records, which is not surprising given that we were actually in lockdown and physical stores were actually closed. But what we've really seen through the whole lockdown period is the big move towards essential spending. And it's been the non-essential, which has effectively moved online and is obviously the consumers' confidence has been affected by people on furlough and also those who are worried about the future of their jobs. We have seen evidence during the course of the summer that we're emerging a slightly more confident nation, but of course we have to still be highly watchful of what's going to happen with further lockdowns, as we've seen in Glasgow overnight. But actually the non-essential purchasing has actually given a real boost to the economy. And again, just turning that back, if you wanted to compare it to the pre-crash of 2008, in 2008 we had, as a nation, we were carrying 150% of household debt as a proportion of household income. That has now fallen to below, to around 120%. But actually what you need to really look at is that in 2008 we had much higher mortgage rates. The fixed rate back then was hovering around 6%, whereas now it's below 2%. So actually the consumer has still got a slightly more confident outlook than we had at the time of the crash, which hopefully will stand us in good stead as we start to emerge more from the lockdown process.
Okay. If I could just add on to my initial bit, Nick, just looking more at the current picture, and with reference to online sales, actually, I think that again, there's been a lot of discussion around where the overall level is going to steady out at, and again, that's, we could probably have a separate webinar on that, but I think we can expect an elevated level of online spend against pre-COVID levels. And there are plenty of consumer surveys that have been completed out there that suggest that we are going to have some shoppers that maintain an increased level of spend online. But having said that, we've been keeping a close eye on the early trend data for both offline and online, and particularly with visits to grocery, health and beauty, and DIY retailer websites. We've actually seen a dip. And as you said in the introduction there, Nick, online spending, that sort of fed through into online spending as well. So how that's feeding through onto the high street, again, we're seeing shoppers visit stores with more and shopping centres and retail destinations with more defined missions. Mm-hmm. So not only are consumers making fewer visits to retail locations and they're shopping at fewer stores per trip, but conversion rates and basket sizes are up. And I think that's partly down to social distancing measures and other safety restrictions. So obviously they're set to remain in place for some form or another until for the rest of the year and almost certainly into early next year. So I think we can expect an elevated level of online spending up to that point.
Okay. So I suppose in conclusion to all that, what we're also saying is the role of the physical store is going to continue to adapt. From what you said just a moment ago, they're certainly still relevant and they're still needed for a profitable operation, but the purpose of the store is going to continue to change effectively. Maybe we can talk about that in a few minutes' time with different types.
Nick, can I just jump in?
Absolutely, Damien. Yeah, please do.
There's one point at the moment which most retailers are facing, because they've effectively discounted very heavily over the past 2 to 3 months to entice people into the shops. So although you've seen footfall down, conversions being up, one of the things they're going to have to transition to over the next quarter as they come into the key seasonal trading is to effectively move away from the discounting model and back to reasonable margins. Mm-hmm. And one of the issues that we're hearing from a range of retailers is that the stock supply isn't quite there, so people actually struggle to secure the right stock levels. So effectively, they have to discount very heavily to move the sort of spring, summer stock, which they was impacted by the lockdown, and they're now struggling to secure the sufficient stock of the autumn, winter collection. And the question is, many consumers have benefited from effectively these significant discounts, but will they move now on to normal margins and this sort of thing? And that's going to be a transition you're going to see over the next 1 to 2 months. And it'd be interesting to see just how that plays out. I don't think anyone knows that. But if you look at the Eat Out to Help Out scheme, that was very, very successful. Most restaurateurs did not expect to be as successful as it was. And so a lot of restaurant groups are potentially insolvent. They're now sitting on significant amounts of cash and they benefit from that scheme. So there is going to be a transition over the next 3 to 6 months, which will, I think, will fundamentally then dictate where the high street goes over the next, you know, 1 to 3 years.
Mm. Well, I've been interested to see on the ETAX help out scheme. We talked about hospitality on a previous webinar, or hotels in particular, but it's clearly still tied into the retail market. I've seen an increasing number of restaurants announcing that they're continuing the ETAX to help out without the government subsidy. It might not be on the same days necessarily, but it's interesting to see how they're trying to continue to get people through the door. But equally, they'll need to start to transition to, you know, back to their full price products, as you say. Perhaps some retailers are hoping for an elongated summer to fulfill their autumn winter collections while they sell off the remainder of their summer stock.
So the problem they had with this summer is effectively it was written off. So it's one of their big pay tickets for the year, because obviously nobody was going on holiday and nobody was going out. So that those summer fashion trends have not really hit the high street at all, other than from the online channel.
Mm. Yeah, okay, that's interesting.
Nick, I think it's important to say that, you know, this was a trajectory we were already on, and we've been talking about the structural change in retail for quite a few years now. And I think, as Matt said, I think this COVID and the lockdown has been an enforced acceleration, really, of the use of online, and probably people that hadn't ever used online before have been forced to do it. So it's probably moved things on a lot quicker as a result of coronavirus. I think it will balance out a bit again. The key thing is that people going forward are going to expect more of an experience from retail than they did before, because they are now used to getting their day-to-day essential online, and retailing and the high street will need to deliver something different to get consumers out there.
So where do you think then, perhaps that leads us on quite nicely to shopping centres and the grocery sector, but I suspect more broadly, where do you think that property owners and funders fit into this equation as the role of the physical store is changing, as the purposes that it's used for is changing? It's still evident at the moment, particularly in London, that these businesses have been affected by the slow return of office workers. We had a question from an audience member in the registration about, are there any regional differentiators? So where do you think the landlords and the funders fit into this equation? Is it going to become more difficult to own retail property, or do you have to be more selective about it? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, if I could jump in on that one, Nick, initially, I think there have actually been a few surprises during lockdown as well, because a certain sector of the shopping centre market, which was more the smaller market town schemes and city suburban schemes, have actually been relatively successful during this process. And the reason being that they tended to be less focused on fashion and much more on essential purchases. So it was on drugstores, food and discounters. And actually, in a way, they've almost been a bit of a... The lockdown has shown that those centres still have value. And it's no accident that at the other end of the spectrum, be it the Inters or the Hammersons, it's the fashion sector that has been particularly hard hit, because that is where the big push has been for online sales. So I think what has to happen, and is already happening, and there's been various announcements on it, is there has to be a correction on two levels. There has to be a correction on the cost base for the retailers, and there has to be a correction and an understanding of the true fall in values of those shopping centre assets.
And do you think those changes in values are going to continue? Is there any insight into when they might settle, or is that a million-dollar question, isn't it?
Well, it's in the case of Trafford Centre, it's more like $1.5 billion question at the moment. I don't think we've found the true level. I think there's still an awful lot of people sitting out on the sidelines waiting to see where this all bottoms out. Because with the particularly shopping centres, you've got other factors that get drawn in, such as business rates? Because if you're, obviously we've been seeing falling vacancy rates, or increasing vacancy rates around the country for the last 10 years. If you're a landlord, you're sitting on your empty rate costs. You've then got your service charge costs, which are eye-wateringly expensive at the moment to run because of the living wage and certain levels of coverage that you have to have within a scheme. So actually running a shopping centre as a business has become more and more of a challenge because the rent receipts have fallen, but the cost base has stayed static or increased. And that is the fundamental challenge, because where do you fix your income and say, this is what the income's going to be worth in the future? Which I know we've got questions on this further down the agenda, but it's like trying to catch a falling knife at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Anyone have anything to add to that?
I think it's a major structural issue for fundamentally the UK economy, because you know shopping centres are largely invested in by pension schemes, which a lot of us invested in, and that stable income stream backed up our pension sector. And the problem now is we're trying to revert to turnover-based rents, which don't support that annuity income that pensions sector needs. So I think it's a major structural issue. But I think fundamentally, in respect of, sort of shopping centres, they're going to have to move on to turnover-based leases. That's where the market is going. It's moving very quickly. And I think funders and investors are just going to have to get their heads around that in some way or form and have to rebase it. I think they'll be looking very closely at the valuers and the professionals to provide them with some form of matrix to justify the new structure, the new system, because I think the old system just doesn't work for the guys at the coalface, basically.
Mm. Peter, do you have any thoughts on that from a lender perspective?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, lenders like certainty, and I think there's going to be a big focus on asset values going forward when you're looking at refinancings and new deals. And so that, have values stabilised, what's the new value look like, is going to be really critical to lending decisions going forward. And I appreciate, you know, lenders hate uncertainty, and we've got a lot of it at the moment, and asset value is going to be a really crucial aspect going forward. And I agree with Damien that the sort of move to turnover based rent seems a smart one. I mean, airports have been doing it for years, but what that does to the values, I mean, we'd look to you guys to give us guidance on what we think something's worth now, but it's going to be a tough period until things settle down a bit, I think.
I think it will continue to be a hybrid model, though, because I don't think the turnover model will suit every single retailer, frankly. I mean, Matt's probably done more work on this, but certainly in the grocery market and the discounter market, I think there's still a move to where they see the rents rebasing. That's where they see the real value in their resetting their cost base. And it's perhaps not want to share the potential upside with all of their landlords. But in the fashion side, where it's much more vulnerable to dips and changes in the seasons, that is really where we're seeing the pressure on moving almost entirely to turnover rent.
Yeah, I suppose they work better in a shopping centre or an outlet scheme, I guess, than they, where you've actually got single ownership of a large area of real estate rather than a granular high street.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's going to be very difficult for, you know, small prop companies or even individual owners if they're having to let shops on turnover only basis. It's going to be a very steep learning curve for them coming out of a very difficult time anyway.
But I think what you're generally seeing, aren't you, is you're seeing a lower base rent with effectively a higher of the base rent, higher of turnover. And the question is, can that be factored into the valuation consideration? And is that sufficient for landlords? And then just see how that develops, basically. But the fundamental issue is that retail sales, unless there's a destination for consumers, do appear to continue to deteriorate as sales move online.
We had a question in, actually, which I might just leave her in here, related to shopping centre M&A activity in recent years. We had I think Klépierre or sort of on-off takeover of Hammerson. Obviously, we've now seen into administration. Is there any improvement on rent collection levels in in shopping centres, or how do we expect that to pan out? And perhaps that links into a broader question: how many of the issues the sector is facing are actually a direct result of CV19 versus has it? I think Lloyd, you already indicated that's really just put it into another gear.
Yeah, Lloyd was entirely right. I mean, it's, you know, to paraphrase David Bowie, it's like trying to put out the fire with gasoline. It really just has absolutely accelerated the effect. I mean, in terms of the bigger shot and the wider shopping centre market, I mean, the likes of Intu, you cannot operate as a business, and Damien may have something to say on this, you cannot operate as a business with that level of debt hanging over you where your business model is changing. And you're still betting on the favourite when the favourite has long since bolted and no longer serves is fit for its purpose. So that level of leverage and actually borrowing money to try and buy your way out of a hole just did not work.
I think that point's very valid in this context. Often when people take debt on, it's based on various assumptions of where the market is going in the future. If those assumptions appear to be invalid, you've then got significant problems. You're over-leveraged. I think that's an issue for many businesses in the current market, because the COVID pandemic has fundamentally undermined many business assumptions, and therefore they've got to look at their existing capital structure, and they need to be fixed. And that's not just the debt. Often it's the equity and also sort of management incentivization and so on. So a lot of businesses do need a wholesale capital restructuring to fundamentally reflect the new norms of business. And that has to be the case with shopping centres. They were a very attractive asset for a period of time, with people seeing many opportunities. They saw stable cash flows. They saw development opportunities. And essentially, they've caught a cold on those. And those values and multiples have moved down. And there is going to have to be a period of quite painful restructuring. But it's been interesting that, you know, many of the acquirers of the shopping centres have been sort of quasi-distressed funds, and they appear to have possibly called some of the market incorrectly. And there'll be others that will be looking to make that call over the next 1 to 5 years. But again, it's a bit like catching a falling knife. You know, when do you dive in and buy some of these schemes? Because they're quite hard. And also, per my understanding, and I'm an accountant, the conversion costs of many of these centres is very, very expensive. So therefore it doesn't lend itself naturally to residential conversion.
Mm. Yeah, just going back to, I mean, the whole thesis of using leverage to enhance the gains on an investment is something we've got very used to. But if you go back to the early 90s, when there was the last big commercial property crash, the same thing had happened. Banks had lent a lot of money to property, and there were some fairly bloody scenes at that time and some big losses. But it did recover quite quickly. And although the main lenders took a lot of hits, there were new investors came in. And as I recall, there were a lot of German banks suddenly came into the market and saw the opportunities. So I think you'll have the same. But a bit like the crash of 08, is it going to take longer for that to happen this time around? Because the tail on COVID is going to take a while to sort of really finish off. So I think that there's some rethinking on investment theses and yields and what's the best way of structuring a deal to get the best out of the value now. So it's going to be tough for a while, I think.
Okay.
Yes, I agree with that in terms of, you know, COVID created basically it stopped the world spinning overnight, didn't it, really? And that was a cash flow issue for retailers, restaurant operators and landlords alike. And until we're out at the other end of this and we're back to some sort of normality, it's going to be very difficult to see where things level out, where values get to, and for that matter, where spend ends up in terms of the balance between online and physical shops. So it's going to be a long road to see where we end up, really.
So picking up on that comment, Lloyd, and sticking with shopping centres for the moment, but it's, I suppose this is not necessarily limited to to shopping centres, it could apply to high street stores. We've had a question from Gemma Jones, thanks Gemma, which ties in quite nicely to something I was going to ask more broadly. I think it was Hammerson that announced recently in Scotland they were going to trial a new flexible leasing model with something called an omni-channel top-up. So whether it's a turnover rent or more of a contracted rent, how in practice does an omni-channel top-up actually work? Or how might it work?
I don't think anyone knows. I think there's big issues around this. And as David said earlier, there's not one size fits all. Certain operators, different retailers, restaurateurs, leisure operators will prefer different scenarios. Some will want turnover, some won't. And I saw a few comments on social media about LinkedIn about this, because and we've had discussions with a number of retailers when you get into turnover related deals. And you know what people tend to forget in the property world is that there is a cost to online. It's not free. You know, there are ISP fees and different fees that the retailers, marketing costs, etc., the retailers incur when trading online, almost like a virtual, you know, they are paying a virtual rent. So it's very difficult to say there is one model that works across the board. And I think what it needs is total transparency between retailers and landlords, and that's the hard thing to achieve, I think. I don't know, David, you probably had a lot more experience in the shopping centre side of things on this sort of stuff.
Well, half it then, because you've also got to consider that as we move into this, if it is omni-channel and it's turnover-based only, it does come down to the cost base. And retailers, you know, previously we talked about leverage within the shopping centre market. I mean, effectively, the shopping centre owners were borrowing money to give to their tenants for their tenants to fit out their stores. Now, that can't happen anymore because that model doesn't work. So the retailers are also looking very hard at what they spend on fitting stores out. And there's a lot of recycling going on as people move into shorter leases or leases with more regular break clauses, because you just cannot write off those costs. So as Lloyd says, it's not going to be one size fits all. And it takes an awful lot of trust to be that transparent. I'm not quite sure we've arrived at that point as a market generally, but I think we're going to have to once we come through the other side of this.
If I could just add a couple of points on new leasing models, Nick, and the Hammerson one is a good example, and there are a number of others that are being floated and sort of banded about out there at the moment. And indeed, we're working on our own unique model ourselves, but it's very much a sort of work in progress. And I think for us, the most important thing are the sort of the two hurdles that are standing in the way. Lloyd's already mentioned one, which is transparency, and we have to have a significant improvement in the level of transparency between landlord and occupier before we can make any progress to a new leasing model. But the other most fundamental point is the access to data. And the amount of landlords that we work with that don't have full transparency about what's happening, even from a footfall perspective, demographic perspective, you know, who's visiting their locations and how they're behaving, and a turnover perspective, a huge number don't have access to these sorts of data sets. And we put out some research earlier this year that went one step further, and we surveyed a group of landlords controlled over 100 million square feet across the country. So it's a national sample size. And 40% of them were still not prepared to share their own insights with occupiers, even in return for sales data. So I think we've got a long way to go before we can even get to a point where we can even implement a new leasing model. And that's something that, you know, that we're working on as a team in terms of improving the quality and accuracy of data landlords have access to.
Okay, thanks, Matt. Well, we're gonna come on to tech and the future leasing model later. I suppose we've picked up on it quite early on. It's the elephant in the room, perhaps. But let's move on from shopping centres and grocery. I'm just conscious of time. And let's talk briefly about the role of government. David, you and I discussed yesterday that the furlough scheme and the business rate relief in the retail sector and extended into other associated areas, of course, alongside C-bills and other measures, have been a lifesaver for many occupational businesses. But what about the challenges that have faced property owners and their financiers? How are they coping? I know we've touched upon this briefly already, but perhaps Peter, David, Damien, you can elaborate on this a bit further.
Yeah, I don't know if Peter and Damien to pick that up first.
Yeah, I'm happy to. I think CBILS has certainly been a lifesaver for a lot of businesses in terms of just, you know, businesses fail because they run out of cash, simple as that. And so this is giving them cash. My concern is when some degree of normality returns, or more importantly, when the annual interest-free period ends and they have to start finding the cash to service the loan, that's going to be when the real stress and pressure is going to come on them. There was a recent survey that was circulated on LinkedIn that only 27% of businesses have a cash flow for the next year, which is quite incredible. And so, you know, I think as professionals on this webinar, we do need to urge people to get good advice and make sure they got a roadmap with a few scenarios as to what might happen to their business. Because certainly as a lender, what you don't want is your borrower coming to you with a last minute surprise because they've suddenly realized they're going to run out of money, you know, imminently. So getting people focused on what's going to happen in the next 12 weeks and the next 6 months is really important to keep businesses under control. I think the government's done a good job as far as it goes, but yeah, we're now seeing some of that unwinding, and now is really the acid test of what happens when business, you know, you take the stabilizer wheels off and you leave the business to cycle on its own. I think that this is going to be a really critical period through to Christmas now. And obviously for retail, the run up to Christmas is an enormously important time. So it's going to be a challenge, and getting your cash flow and your stock right is going to be enormously important.
In terms of, to elaborate on that, in terms of a lender, whether it's a bank or another, determining which of its customers to support, do you think it's fair to say that there'll be some distinction made now between the businesses that were perhaps already struggling pre-COVID as opposed to those that weren't, but they've obviously now been plunged into difficulty?
Well, there's been a lot obviously written about CBILS, and the whole intention, it was a business interruption loan. So in theory, if your business was struggling beforehand, you shouldn't qualify for one. It should only be those businesses in reasonably robust health that have, you know, a gym that was working perfectly well and has suddenly had to stop. That needs an interruption loan. But a business that, you know, casual dining we've talked about before, it possibly shouldn't have qualified. But I think there's been a fairly wide interpretation of what counts as business interpretation to keep businesses going, because the alternative, some of these businesses, if you're attempting to put them into administration now, there's nothing there. Who's going to buy a business that you don't know when it's going to start operating? So it's a tough time. I think the government has done what it can. Other governments in other countries seem to be extending these schemes, but I think you have to at some point say, right, you're on your own, now figure out what you're going to do. The rate relief, I'll leave others to comment on that. I don't know when that unwinds and what the cash impact of things like that is on particularly this sector.
I think the rate relief at the moment is until March 2021, I believe, unless there's any extension. But on the business rate side, whilst we had the rate relief, the government has also delayed the business rate revaluation until 2023. So businesses, even when they start to repay their rates or start paying them again, will be paying business rates based on values which are now two, three or more years out of date. So that's going to put them in a difficult spot, because I suspect those business rates will be massively out of kilter with the actual open market rental value.
Well, as a tax it is anyway. I mean, the government, our industry has been lobbying the government for decades to actually overhaul the whole business rate system. And funnily enough, I was reviewing some newspaper articles from when Gordon Brown introduced empty rates in 2008. And even going back then, that's 12 years ago, that our industry was throwing their arms up in horror to say, you can't do this. You're effectively taxing inactivity. You think you are putting it in a place to incentivize us to let buildings. But even in 2008, and this was post-crash, obviously, there was just not the retailers there, or the market was fairly turgid. So I think the government, the business rates holiday has effectively kept a large number of businesses in this country afloat during the last 6 months. And unless there is a major overhaul of the entire system, I think it's just going to create yet more problems as we come out of COVID. It's going to be the same problems we had before. So actually, but in terms of what you'd encourage the government to do, is actually it's about taxing business activity, not just taxing something because it's sitting there empty. So whether it's corporation tax, which would be unpopular, but actually if they incentivize building businesses to open stores or for regeneration, hopefully that would put people back to work, and they would see the returns in income tax. I suppose the other role is, do they devolve more of the business rate system to local government, who are much more aware of their local issues and looking at it on the ground? Because effectively, although we businesses pay the business rates locally, it goes into a central pot and is then reallocated. Why not break the link in that chain?
Mm. And the other thing surely has got to be that whilst the multiplier is around 50 pence, it's effectively a 50% tax, which is, you know, there aren't many other taxes that are running at that sort of percentage, are there?
Well, within our industry,
I can think of.
No, well, I mean, with our industry, our peers and ourselves, we have been letting shops for a long time where the business rates is more than the rent that you pay. And there is something fundamentally wrong with that equation. And the fact that it's only now that we're actually seeing any form of activity is one of the crimes of the whole retail, the government's treatment of the whole retail industry. Because it shouldn't be lost on people that retail and hospitality directly employ more than double the number of employees in the NHS. And when you look at that, it's a fairly stark, statistic. And just shows how important retail is to our whole economy.
Mm. I think, and even though Damien.
If you speak to international retailers, they are stunned with our rating system and our taxation system in the UK. They just can't understand it. And when they look at it from a competitive position, they think it's completely unviable. And often you've got to try and explain it in detail to global CEOs. So it's something that has to be addressed. And they do have to look at the economic consequences of internet sales, online transactions, because fundamentally, as we alluded to, so many people work in the sector. It's important for the fabric of our society that we have people working in retail. You know, we have high streets at work. And they do have to look at this online taxation because of the downside effects. You know, you look at the profitability of online businesses. It's out of kilter with the rest of society. And that's where the taxation has to move to, effectively. And the government's just been too late in the day on this. The problem will be is that fundamental consumers will then have to pay more for these cheap online transactions. And there may be some pushback on that. But somehow the government has to recoup some money because they can't continue to rate businesses as they have done historically.
And even though we've got retail, the extended retail relief scheme at the moment for another few months, as David, as you pointed out, that doesn't apply where the units are actually vacant. So no. the incentives or the buoyancy aids have obviously been given to our trading businesses, who of course are essential, as you say, about employing so many people. But if you've got a landlord, whether it's a shopping centre, retail park or high street with vacancies, they're still picking up the voids. And then that obviously leads into the, as we've seen, David, in some recent examples, the impact that has on their net cash position and in turn how they can service their interest payments. So do you guys think perhaps, Damien, you mentioned about Europe. Do you think that our government, whilst what they've done has been very helpful, do you think actually they should have adopted more of a shared approach between stakeholders rather than perhaps focusing on the occupational businesses?
I think the problem with everything with the government, and I do feel for them, that they're very reactive. Things are moving so quickly. It's very difficult to come up with a strategy when you've only had 5 months to put something in place. So, and also they've been looking at they've been trying to avoid mass failure on the high streets to protect those high streets. And they'll have to deal with the structural issues we've alluded to over a period of time. But you know, you've got to feel for some individuals whose pension schemes are linked to properties who are landlords who are suffering. You know, there are when you talk about landlords, you know, people think about large commercial landlords, but there are individuals out there who are suffering because the income stream funded their pension effectively. And I think the government has to look at that. It's going to be interesting with the moratorium expiring at the end of this month to see how the government looks to deal with that, because you know, the landlords are legitimately saying that a number of retailers are fundamentally taking the piss in terms of the approach they're adopting. They're just not engaging. And I agree there has to be some form of transition to trying to work together. And I think there are the problem is that in any debate, 80% of people are sensible. There's always going to be 20% on both sides who are difficult, and often they are the loudest. And I think that is the issue we've got at the moment. And I do think we will transition because I think people are quite sensible. You know, Inch is a good example. Since it's gone to administration, you've seen obviously the administrators and the Inch staff be very realistic because of the nature of what they've got to do and what they've got to achieve. And you are seeing that with the other landlords. And it's interesting at the moment looking at the landlords commenting on some of the restructuring proposals. I think many of their comments are quite legitimate. You know, it's one way trading effect at this stage. I think that, that does have to be addressed. The government has to consider that.
We've had a question here from Chris Tate, which I just want to lever in quite quickly. You mentioned online taxation, Damien. The question here is, to what extent do you think the new 2% digital tax will even the playing field between online and bricks and mortar?
It fundamentally still doesn't sound very much if you think about what retailers are paying. So I haven't seen the taxation numbers to state how much that's going to raise. And it would be also interesting to understand the interaction with the BV and obviously Brexit kicking in as well. I haven't seen the data on that to see what the figures are, but at some stage I can imagine that's a quite easy one for the government to keep uplifting to sort of fix its own balance sheet.
Yeah, 2% doesn't sound very much, does it, on the face of it, certainly. Well, I'm sure we could talk about the role of government all day, and we did have another question more broadly. Is government doing enough? Perhaps we've encapsulated that. I want to move on, just because I'm conscious of time, to regeneration and repurposing. And Lloyd, I'm sure you've got some interesting things to say about this. Perhaps it's worth pointing out, first of all, for those that aren't aware, if we can skip to the next slide, please. I hope you guys watching can see this. We've just put up there some brief comments, and further info is available after the webinar, if you'd like, on the planning changes, which came into effect yesterday. Whereby we've got a new Class E, which is a new use category, which now encapsulates what we previously knew as A1 retail shops, A2 financial and professional services, A3 bars and restaurants, also B1 businesses, so offices, and non-residential institutions. They're all now within the same use class, and changing a property between those different uses does not require planning consent, which is a pretty large change. And there's also a new Class F for local community and learning purposes. And we've got a couple of questions from the audience, including Adrian Doble. Thanks, Adrian. Glad to have you with us. The question is, how with local towns and communities do we repurpose properties and areas of the high street rather than having so many vacant shops, or indeed the sort of sorry to use a phrase, this is my phrase, not Adrian's, the filler shops that we sometimes see sitting in what otherwise would be vacant. What are you doing at the moment, Lloyd, in terms of the repurposing regeneration?
Well, should I start with the planning?
Absolutely.
Because obviously that's pretty topical, just come in yesterday. Firstly, I think that anything that speeds up the planning process is a good thing. And actually, in in recent years, much the same as what we've said about the consumer trends, that the supply of oversupply of a retail property as something that we've been dealing with for the last few years. It's not, this isn't a new thing. You know, we've seen the demise of BHS through to Debenhams and lots of others in the middle over the last 3 or 4 years. And I think that councils generally have woken up to that anyway in terms of planning and been much more open to changes of use and converting retail space into other uses. The issue invariably is time and resource within councils and the speed in which they can deal with these applications for changes of use. I think the old sort of protection of retail on the high street, we used to have these policies where 75% of retail frontage had to be A1. You know, even trying to get a restaurant in 10 years ago was an absolute nightmare. I think that has changed significantly in the last decade anyway. And, you know, we haven't got councils saying, well, this has been a department store forever, so it has to be a department store. We've had a number of projects we've worked on recently where we've converted retail buildings or department stores to a hotel or resi, and there's zero retail in it going forward. And that's what's going to happen because there is a significant oversupply. One thing is, I think that with these changes, I think councils will have to retain control because, you know, it's very easy for the government to say, well, we'll just let the market dictate and just get on with it. But I think we need an element of control, and that's what the planning system's for, to curate the town centres and city centres that we're dealing with and have a strategy in place.
And with 25% of BHS stores still sitting vacant since the 2016 administration, clearly that town planning fabric needs to shift, doesn't it? So whether it's retail to resi, perhaps, is that something that you would expect to see more of?
Yeah, I mean, it totally depends on the location, and it totally depends on the demand from alternative uses. And more importantly, I think Damien touched on earlier, it depends on the building, the type of building you're dealing with, whether it's a shopping centre, whether it's a block on a high street, whether it's a department store. It depends on the structure that you're dealing with. You know, we're working on things right through from grade two listed, you know, former old family run department stores through to, you know, 1970s concrete shopping centres. So, and everything again in between. So there's not, similar to what we said about the turnover deals, there's not one size fits all, and you've got to look at, I think what councils need to do with in addition to these planning changes is work out what uses they want in their towns. Some towns have become just retail destinations. They've grown over the last few decades to provide consumers with the fashion and the retail that they want. And as that shrinks and the way we shop changes, we need to identify what are the uses we want in those towns, what's going to work, and how we go about it. And it's, you know, it's going to be a slow, long, you know, difficult process. But we're already seeing some good examples. We're already seeing a lot of resi going into town centres. Prior to coronavirus, quite a lot of hotel development, still in good markets around the UK, and under supply of hotel rooms. And we've seen a lot of department stores have lent themselves quite well to conversion into hotels in most cases. So we've seen a lot of that. And yeah, I think it's going to be an evolving thing over the next decade, if not longer.
Okay.
I think fundamentally as well, though, as part of that regeneration, retail and leisure still play a part.
Oh, yeah.
There's not a case of, I know you've worked on projects where there's no retail going back in, but actually, there, if you're introducing a large number of apartments onto a site which was previously just for retail, the people that are going to live there want somewhere to shop. The unfortunate thing is that a lot of these buildings have actually reached the end of their economic life anyway, are no longer fit for purpose. They are very expensive to redevelop, and things just have to stack, frankly. And the values will be driven largely by the residential element, where if you turn the clock back 15, 20 years, the residential tended to be an add-on or an afterthought.
Yeah. We had a similar question from Mark Riley. Mark, I hope you've answered that. Sorry, Peter.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting. I think it was Lloyds I saw are encouraging staff that would typically go into a big central office to just go and work in a local branch which has got spare capacity. So rather than the high street lenders closing all these branches, maybe there'll be a return to some sort of hub and spoke and satellite, and that'll be another repurposing on the high street. So rather than, you know, a couple of office workers getting on a train and going into London, they'll go into a remote working site where they'll be more plugged in. And at least then you're getting footfall into the high street that way. So little initiatives like that you might see develop as we move forward.
Yeah, okay. Definitely. That's a use that we're talking about more and more, co-working and hubs in suburban locations in former retail units. And it will totally differ. It will totally depend on the town and the location and. In every town across the country, it will be different.
Well, I'm sure we could talk more about retail repurposing and obviously how it's all funded as well in another time. But let's move on. I'm conscious of time too. We'll talk a little bit about the recently enacted Corporate Insolvency and Governance Bill. Damien, Peter, try and bring you guys in on a few of these as well. It has, of course, some temporary measures, which, Damien, you alluded to just now, in terms of the moratorium against stat demands and winding up positions, which I think ends at the end of this month. And it has some permanent measures, including this new freestanding moratorium and also a new restructuring plan, which is a bit similar to the Chapter 11 over in the States. So do you guys think that perhaps as we get into Q4, we can expect to see a marked increase in winding up petitions? And therefore, do you think these new tools might start to be used?
I think in terms of these new tools, they haven't been tested yet. I appreciate obviously Virgin Atlantic have used the first restructuring plan. But if you look at them, they are very expensive insolvency processes. You need a lot of advisors around. So sort of the de minimis fees really are sort of, I think, $250,000, $500,000. That's our assessment as it stands. So it's not going to lend itself to sort of the UK mid-market or SME market as it stands. I think what you'll then see over a period of time is very similar to company branch arrangements, is there will be a level of best practice in which they can be adopted. But I think you'll see that these new tools will assist larger organisations, but they won't be applicable sort of the mid-market in the short term. But I think what you'll then see is them rolling out potentially over 6 to 18 months. That there are, I think, our existing insolvency tools, the company voluntary arrangements, the pre-pack administrations were pretty powerful tools and could have been amended. I think one of the key things which is going to have a big impact on the insolvency market and also the lending market is the HMRC is getting its Crown preference back from 1st of December. So effectively they became priority creditor. And I think that is going to be a key factor in, sort of, in terms of driving processes and driving restructuring. So I think the actual amendments to legislation, the short-term reliefs have been beneficial and have really assisted the market. But I think a lot of the tools were always there, really. And I think, you know, there is just nuances to all of this. I think our legislation actually stands in good stead as compared to other countries, especially in Europe. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a positive, basically.
Okay. So you mentioned CVAs, and they are, of course, a pretty effective tool for addressing fixed overheads in particular. Not that that's where they are, that's where they stop, but I think it's for that reason that we've seen in recent years they've become what perhaps we could call property-focused CVAs being used, particularly by businesses with large or what have become oversized occupational estates. And David, I know you and I talked about recently the research that Colliers has done in the past about how and where CVAs have been used and perhaps how effective they are. And in some cases, operators using them sometimes more than once, but still ultimately failing.
Well, yeah. So,
what do you think that tells us about the CVAs that we're seeing now? Because I feel like the CVA proposals are becoming almost more radical, for want of a better word, in terms of the depth of the changes
they are, that we make. They are, but I suppose if you turn the clock back, it was almost a form of CVA creep. What can we get away with this time? What can we get away with this time? And we're now sitting in an environment where if you're a retailer, if ever you were going to rebase your bricks and mortar estate onto a footing where you actually felt the business could survive and you get a lot more buy-in from your other creditors and your bankers, now's the time to do it. Hence the ones that we are seeing, with the, if we're mentioning names, the New Look one, which does look radical. But we've already been speaking about how the market is moving towards a much more turnover-based model. In a way, it's been a long time coming, because frankly, 2 years ago, such a radical CVA would never have got voted through. Mm. And as we've discussed previously as well, very few CVAs have actually been rejected. I mean, some have had a bit of last-minute brinkmanship to try and get all of their creditors on board. Very few have actually failed because the retailers have tended to pitch them where they pretty much know they're going to get a pass rate. But now it has to be radical, because frankly, if it doesn't, the next step would be a pre-pack or a full administration where an estate might disappear altogether. You might just see somebody buying a name, or it will just be drastically reduced, which gets back to the fundamental problem that we do not need hundreds more shops coming immediately to the market, because the market still needs time to absorb them as we go through this polarization and regeneration process.
Damien, I know you've worked on some CVAs recently where you've had success. Are there any sort of additional ingredients that you think are really key rather than just addressing your fixed cost?
I think you need to use a CVA to look at the overall business. I don't think it's fair just to take chunks out of landlords in these processes. I think you've got to look at your overall capital structure, your refinancing, new equity, but also look at taking costs out of your supplier base and your non-critical creditors. I think that's important to get that balance right. I think historically there have been too much focused on landlords, which fundamentally haven't fixed many of the issues. So then you have seen these sort of second and third wave CVAs where landlords are much more cynical. I think one of the problems in the current market is that there was a sort of a change in tone from landlords essentially saying to retailers, you know, don't propose any more CVAs, we'd rather have the shops back. But then you saw a wave of administrations where the retailers tried to hand the shops back and the landlords didn't want them back. So I think now there's an understanding of landlords that they'd rather see CVAs. But the issue you've got is, as you alluded to, on the New Look CVA, the landlords do not like some of the fundamentally rewriting those contracts. That's the issue. They do not like the turnover based rents, and they do not like the fact that you will change the lease fundamentally at the end of the CVA period. Those are key red lines as far as they're concerned, and that's a major issue for landlords.
But if we do think, then perhaps this sort of leads us on from corporate insolvency into our final section, which is about a future leasing model. So we'll kind of almost pick up where we started off. If we think that a business, whether it be a retailer or casual dining or similar, genuinely needs to transition its business model, whether it's occupational or other factors, on a wholesale basis, cost effectively, do you think that we can expect to continue to see CVAs utilised, maybe to put a business from a contractual rent onto a turnover one, because otherwise they'll have to approach each landlord individually and it will probably take them years and then end up with a real hodgepodge of different leasing structures.
From what I can see, most retailers are actually adopting CVAs because they can't consensually negotiate decent terms unless they've got a sufficient threat in some way for them. So they're having to use CVAs because they can't consensually negotiate with landlords. As you stated, it takes months and years to negotiate amendments to lease terms. At least by you do in a CVA in sort of 1 to 2 months, or it might take sort of 1 to 2 years, and that it stops the cash bleed. And most CVAs that we've worked on, they change the business overnight because you reduce the rentals down significantly. You write costs off of it, but, and they fundamentally change a business. And that is the benefit of CVA. Otherwise, you get stuck into prolonged negotiations with landlords. And it'll be interesting to see what happens at the end of this month when the moratorium ends, because there's a range of CVAs being proposed, but then how landlords negotiate. And I get the impression that a range of landlords lost patience, and you'll see a load of winding up petitions coming in, really going quite hard at a range of different retailers. So The problem you've got is there's this endless battle reflecting the structural shifts in retail between landlords and tenants.
Mm. Well, perhaps, as you said earlier, if it's those 20% that don't want to play ball, that's perhaps where you'll see some of the more, I don't know, the more aggressive action being taken once those options are back on the table.
Yeah, but on the same basis, in the current market, with so much uncertainty, the time to do a CVA is now. You know, because the funders, stakeholders, even landlords, that they would rather have certainty. At least CVA provides certainty, whereas administration offers you nothing. And so that's why you're seeing these more aggressive CVAs, because people believe that there's a one-off opportunity to fundamentally restructure, fix their businesses. And that's what you're seeing in some of the negotiations. I think that's, look at the commentary at the weekend from the British Property Federation in respect of the new look CVA. That was the point that they made, but again, I think it's the point that the company making is that they want to fundamentally rewrite the contractual position between the landlord and tenant, and that's why the landlord's pushing back on it, because they do not want that the age-old position being amended.
Mm. Unless, of course, no,
the leasing model was already changing anyway, and that's why so many estates have been pushing for shorter leases and regular break clauses, because it gives them that chance to check their cost base every time. Of course, When you've got a great range of lease expiries and break dates, a CVA is a very useful tool, because it effectively means you can do it all in a one-er and not piecemeal, which just only improves the bottom line by small increments.
Mm. I guess the challenge that property owners have got as well is, as we touched on earlier, they have also got their own financial commitments to meet in terms of their own debt obligations and interest rates, and therefore changing the structure and the frequency of rent payments is going to have a knock-on effect. So, I mean, we've got the last slide up about bringing in some tech, and Matt, perhaps you've got some thoughts on this as well. How do you think our property owners and funders can also start to use tech and data to make sure that all the way through the chain we have an arrangement that works for the funder, the owner, and the occupier?
I think certainly from a tech perspective, this is something that we're focusing the vast majority of our efforts on at the moment. The space is rich with options today. And I think, again, to use that same phrase, COVID's accelerating the need for data across any estate, and there's no one size fits all that, you know, that fits a shopping centre and might work differently for a high street. So without doubt, now's the time to discuss a data-driven approach to leasing. Landlords are under more pressure to deliver, you know, sort of prove that their strategies are indeed delivering. So high quality, high quantity footfall data is really important. And that's a big priority for us going forward.
Okay. Guys, we are now just over an hour. We've still got about 100 people watching, but if I can ask you all for sort of closing thoughts, and then we'll pass it back to Peter for his wrap-up comments.
I was just going to link on to what Matt just said there. in terms of footfall and turnover, I think we've got to look at both with how we structure leasing deals. At the end of the day, if you're a landlord with an asset, with a shopping centre or an environment where you're providing space for retailers, leisure operators, then if you're delivering the footfall by creating the environment, that's one step towards generating the turnover. And I think that's an interesting thing that we need to look at more going forward. And I also think that we talked about how a lot of these investments are run by pension funds and who relied on annuity style incomes, 4 rent checks a year for, in some cases, 30-year leases. And what's evident now is that's not going to exist going forward. And landlords and investors and funders have got to look at these assets in terms of what the net income these things are going to produce, as more like an operational business, like a hotel or a residential investment. And it's getting our heads around how we value that and how we analyse that going forward, I think.
Mm. Yeah. Well, I'd just like to say, I mean, it might sound ironic sitting where we are at the moment, but this is still now a market of opportunity, because there's going to be activity, although a lot of it does feel negative. But I think it's for all the stakeholders involved in what is one of the most fundamental industries in the UK, all the stakeholders need to fully engage and get back to the two words we've used a lot here is trust and transparency, and have a proper dialogue, and actually come up with rational and informed strategies and decisions. And if we can do that as an industry within ourselves and with government help and proper dialogue, I'm actually relatively optimistic about the future, because in a way, we just have to embrace this change. It's coming, and as we've said, it's coming quicker. We just have to react and deal with it, frankly.
Mm, yeah, absolutely. Damien, do you have any final points to add before we bring in Peter to close us off?
No, I think the key thing is it's still the market's evolving. I think there's so many dynamics. We could be a very different conversation in 3 months to 12 months. I do think there's a lot of opportunity here at the moment, because there's so much volatility. So when there is this level of change, it does create opportunities for people who are shifting their feet, basically.
Okay. Well, thanks everybody for your comments. And Peter, I'll hand over to you for your closing remarks.
Yeah. Thanks, Nick. And thanks everyone for the time and effort and thought you've put into this. Just to echo some of the thoughts there, I think change does breed opportunity, and we are seeing perhaps a 10-year change happening in a year. And I mean, retail's always been considered an art rather than the science, but I think Matt has confirmed to us that I think the science is becoming ever more important, and I think that will be leading a lot of the change. So that's my closing thought. There's more information on this on Collier's website and on the TMA website, and there will be a recording of this for those that missed some of it. So thank you all the attendees. We were well over 100 at various times, so really appreciate all of your attention and for dialing in. And to the panelists, once again, a big thank you for your time and effort in preparing this, and Collier's for helping organise this. So, thanks, and have a good rest of the day.
Cheers.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.